Thank you for joining us. Welcome to this edition of Live Fire on the Gun Owners News Hour. Today, I want to talk a little bit about the law. Brent Allan Winters is himself an attorney, and he's written a book which I imagine some police officials might find provocatively entitled, Don't Talk to the Police. Period, paragraph, next subject. Does that about sum it up, Brent?
That about does it. You may as well hit the nail on the head if you can.
You made a reference early in the book to the criminal law industry. Now, that could be taken perhaps in one of two related ways. One is an industry that has been made out of criminal law, and the other, criminal law as an industry. In any case, we're
a criminal lawyer and a lawyer that practices in the criminal law.
So, that being said, we do have a serious problem. We have a growing militarization of our police force, and we've dealt with that on this program. And inherently, police view themselves, I think, as having a monopoly of force and often are not very happy with the idea that subjects are able to walk around packing a piece in our purse or our pocket. And there seems to be a growing rift between we the people and people that should consider themselves our employees, who only have police power because that power was delegated to them from us, because we the people inherently possess the police power.
Well said, Larry. And I'm glad to hear you say what you've said for two reasons. Number one, I get to thinking I'm the only one that's seeing this, and then I say to myself, well, maybe it's just me. My experiences have altered my point of view to where I'm not thinking like other people. But when I hear folk like you say this, and I've heard others say it too, it makes me feel like, well, maybe I'm not so far out there. Matter of fact, I'm convinced of it myself, but still it's refreshing to know there are others of like mind and that do see the same thing. And I see a rift growing also, and it's unfortunate. But I remember when I was younger, police officers wore ties. They don't now. They wear combat uniforms. And I say without hesitation, there's no need for it. And it incites fear, and fear then incites the possibility of violence. A lot of what I think I'm seeing as the police state is a result, not of people. It's the result of policemen, the police forces taking the position that it's us versus them, and they foster the idea more among people that we should not look at, talk to, or have anything to do with police officers. Now, the title of the book, Don't Talk to the Police, I didn't make that up. That Supreme Court said that on different occasions, and as have other federal courts and state courts. But the Supreme Court has said it, and of course our Constitution says it implicitly and recognizes the danger of talking to government employees.
And there's a good biblical example of keeping one's mouth buttoned, and that was during the illegal trial of Christ. He simply did not open his mouth to the point that the governor in charge, the chief thug in charge, marveled that he said nothing. Don't you have anything to say to those who are accusing you? Of course, he overlooked a little bit about the accusers were contradicting themselves, so if they're doing such a bad job, why should Christ have anything to say?
You make a good point, and it says there that he was, expanding the translation a little bit, but it says that the Roman governor there, Pilate, was downright stunned. He couldn't understand why he wouldn't talk. And if people learn, of course the Bible in other places, that's a good example, but it says in other places that we should be quick to hear and slow to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And as a matter of fact, prudence tells us without the Bible, just the law of nature and experience, that it's wise to be quiet and more than be talkative. Speak often, heard little, and speak little, heard often.
Mm-hmm.
But we see it also. The problem is, though, with the rising police state, I don't know what else to call it. It has become an industry, an unlawful industry, and it needs to be said that many, many, many of the people in prisons are there not because they have committed a crime, but because the legislature has manufactured a crime, and then the political powers, because they didn't like the person or the way they're thinking or the way they're talking, they're jailed. And there's a million, there's over 5,500 and approaching 6,000 federal crimes now. That's just federal.
We here at Gun Owners confront that a lot. We're involved in speech, both as lobbyists and as those involved in political campaigns. And you can go to jail real easily for simply exercising your right to speak. Because if you don't do it and dot all the I's and do it exactly the way our masters have laid out as permissible, then the right to our free speech, where Congress shall pass no law, goodness, how many laws do we have just in the area of speech? I don't know how else to put it than we're dealing with a lawless government. The idea that the Constitution binds them may have been something that the founders articulated, but these guys would choke if they had to say something like that.
No question. I'm looking for a critical mass of Americans, and it doesn't have to be a majority, but a critical mass that will stand firm and say, no, that's not the law. I don't care what the Congress says. That's unconstitutional, besides being against the law of God, as we used to say often in America. And anything that's against the law of God is lawless. We're pushed to the point now where it's time we go back to the fundamentals of the fundamentals and say what is lawful, what is not. If we go to the Constitution, that's easy enough to see what's lawful and what is not. The resolutions of Kentucky and Virginia, I believe they were called the resolutions of 98, pointed out that the Constitution only mentions four kinds of crimes. And any prosecution for anything beyond that is unconstitutional. And those were put forth by those resolutions by none other than James Madison and Thomas Jefferson, if my memory served me correctly. And
they're also known as the resolutions of nullification.
Nullification. Yes, and the point being, the states had the power to say, now wait a minute. And the strength of America, we are the greatest engine of wealth and prosperity that the human race has ever known or could have ever imagined. And the reason is because we've been free to speak and free not to speak. I was recently back in my neck of the woods where I'm from, and Terre Haute, Indiana. I'm not from right at Terre Haute, but around there. But I was over there, and that's the home of Clabber Girl Baking Powder. And they have a little a plant there downtown. Tony Holman used to own the. He's gone
Let's
now.
Let's get back to baking powder in just a minute or two after these announcements. Talking with Brent Allan Winters about don't talk to the police. Well, you never know what you're going to hear about on the live fire at the Gun Owners News Hour, but you're going to hear a little bit about something to do with baking powder. Go ahead, Brent.
Well, what I was going to say, Clabber Girl Baking Powder, and they have a little museum downstairs in the old building, and I was reading letters that Tony Holman's grandfather had written home to his brother in Germany. That's where he was a German immigrant. He wrote home to his brother, said, you must come to America. He said, over here, he said, we can say what we want. And that phrase, we can say what we want, is stuck in my mind. That letter is posted up on the wall there in a frame.
That's a great testimony to the country.
Oh, and of course, then him feeling freedom to speak, he felt freedom to do, and he just got busy, like a hard, thrifty German man that he was, and he put together a baking powder company, because that's what he knew how to do, but he had freedom, and his brother did come, and then they worked together. But freedom of speech is the foundation of so many things. If we can't be free to speak, we don't have much left. And the two places that are really important for freedom of speech, foundational, are the courts and the churches, the pulpits, as we used to say. If we do not have dissenting opinions in the court, and they aren't allowed, as they are not allowed in most of the world, by the way, we've lost our freedom of speech, and of course we don't see it in the pulpits, as we don't now, we've lost it. But the flip side of freedom of speech, it's the flip side of the same coin, the same fundamental thing, is the right to remain silent.
Mm-hmm.
And how important that is. Of the hundreds of men that I've known that have been jailed, I would say safely, but 60%, if not 80% of them, if they had buttoned their lips or had not had something in writing that they had said, they would have walked. And as I pointed out before, many people are in jail not because they've committed a crime, but because the legislature says this or that innocent behavior is now criminal.
I can testify to what you're saying. Many years ago, I had obtained a firearm and decided to sell it because, for one thing, I saw legislation coming in the state, and so I unloaded it through a legal private transaction. But because I had purchased it on record, it was in a dealer's books. Eventually, the ATF discovered that Larry Pratt had one of these terrible guns, and ATF called House and an unlisted number and wanted to talk to me. And I said, well, it's not convenient right now. And they said, well, we got to talk to you. I said, well, it's not convenient right now. Well, we got to talk to you. I said, I'll talk to you when I have an attorney. Otherwise, goodbye. And they came to the office one day. Happily, I was out at a meeting, and they left their card, and we got to talk to him. So at that point, I did call the GOA attorney and told him what was happening. And we met in our conference room, and as we were sitting down and just about ready to get the meeting underway, the attorney pulls out a tape recorder, that's how long ago that was, and plopped it on the desk, the conference table, and the ATF agent looked at that and said, well, if you're going to do that, this makes this an official meeting. And like it wasn't an official meeting, please give me a break. I know I look stupid, but I'm really not that stupid. So, but I think that, and happily, it went, once they realized that they had to behave, that first of all, there were two witnesses now, and one of them was an officer of the court, well, that kind of changes the way they're going to try to smack mouth you.
No question. And the reason the Fifth Amendment's there is for that very reason, because it's there for the innocent as well as the guilty. And if the guilty are not availed the right to exercise their right of freedom of silence, then the innocent aren't free to do it either. I've had the only people that have been upset about this book, it's been received nicely otherwise, are police officers that have seen...
Oh, no. Tell me it's not true.
Yeah, and that was a learning curve for me. I thought, well, maybe there's some out there that have sensibilities about right and wrong and our Constitution, but to my dismay, and this was at a Christian meeting where this occurred, where I had my books out, and I figured people there would have Christian sensibilities. I found out they didn't, and one of them said to me, he was a sheriff's deputy from the Midwest, he said, well, I have the right to know what people know. So I said, people have the right to be quiet. He said, well, I have the right to know. Now he said, we've got a conflict of rights. And of course, we don't in that situation.
No, because he's making up
police
a right.
Officer's rights don't trump anything. Police officer doesn't have any rights in the sense of constitutional rights that he needs to
They have
put
duties.
Forward.
They have responsibilities.
Yes, right. That is right. Larry, that is right. Here, I'm using the word again. That's an important word we can talk about sometime. It's an old Germanic word, and it means really responsibilities, duties. When we say right now, we think about selfishness, and that's not what this is about. God has given jurisdiction to each of us, control, government, if you will, over our bodies, and that includes our tongues. And James says, if you can control your tongue, you can control your entire body, just as a ship is controlled by a rudder, something so small, or something as small as the bit in a horse's mouth controls a horse. If you can control your tongue, you can control your body. God has given us government over our bodies, and he's says control them, and control of the tongue is an important part of that. Sometimes God would want you to speak, sometimes he won't, and I don't second guess another person's sensibilities about this, but I know it's always safe in doubt to control your tongue and not to speak. Be swift to hear and slow to speak. And I guess the rule might be good stated this way: if another person does not have a lawful right to the information that you are to say, you really don't need to say it. Matter of fact, it'd be best if you didn't. And the question then comes down to one thing. Does that police officer, the judge, or whoever, could just be a neighbor, do they have a right to the information they're wanting me to tell them? And you must make a choice. The other strength of America is, among many, is that every person is responsible before God to do his duty and do the law. And he cannot, he will not be able to, stand behind someone else who told him what he could and couldn't do as a shield, telling him what's right and what's wrong. Each person, each man, each woman must decide for themselves. And it comes down to, shall I speak or shall I not speak? That is fundamental, Larry. And to control the tongue is everything. So the right to speak is important. Of course, you, people who jabber like magpies, that's not always smart. And
yet we'll be confronted with the notion that, well, if you don't have anything to hide, then why don't you speak?
Oh, well, I'm glad you brought that up. And that is a cabal of the devil. Because just because I have the truth does not mean that the other person who wants it is entitled to it. Because the law says, our Supreme Court has said, and our federal courts have acknowledged, and our this comes out of our Fifth Amendment right to remain silent, that even though what you say may be true, and even though it may exonerate you if taken right, it will, not it may, it will, if you're going to be targeted, it will be twisted against you, and every word you speak, I tell you, I've seen it in the courts and I've read the cases, every word you speak will be brought to bear against you.
And I'm back with more Live Fire on the Gun Owners News Hour, talking today with Brent Allan Winters, who has produced a book called Don't Talk to the Police. You can get it at commonlawyer.com. And to remind you, Brent is an attorney himself. This is precisely the advice he would give to anyone who's his client. It's advice that had been given to me many years ago. I think it's served very well, and for those who refuse to be intimidated, and there are ways that we can be intimidated, but if we refuse to be intimidated and we keep our lips buttoned, we're doing well. Brent, you were talking about what the federal courts have spoken on this issue.
Yes, the federal courts have said that if the information that if the information that is being sought from you could provide a link in a chain that could lead a prosecutor to information that would entice him to prosecute you, then you are entitled to silence before the court. Now, that's not before the police. That's a different matter. Before the court under oath. I mean, they're related matters, but there are differences also. So think about what you're about to say. When you come to talking to the police, listen, when the police officer talks to someone, they're not seeking to help them. They're looking to accuse somebody. That's their job. They would tell you that anyway. Shouldn't always be their job, but it is. That's
well, if they can't find any criminals, why should we even be paying them to begin with?
Well, that's a good point, Larry. Very good point. They're looking to accuse, and so anything you say is going to, they're going to use it to lead them to an accusation if they can at all. And if that accusation comes down on you, then what you say, and that's why the Miranda rights fell into place, and if you ever, people know those things, they've heard it in the movies so much, anything you say can be used against you in a court of law. Well, it certainly can, but I say beyond that, if you go to a court of law as a defendant, it will be used against you. So it's just wise not to talk. Nothing you say to a police officer is going to make him believe that you're innocent. If he's got his eyes fixed on you, it's not going to change his point of view one bit. I can't tell you how many people I've been involved with as clients that couldn't get on the witness stand or wouldn't or shouldn't get on the witness stand because they had given a statement to the police. And the police then will take that statement and then they will use it to try to rip apart a defendant or a witness of any kind on the witness stand. And they usually can't remember everything they said. They can't remember exactly how they said it. And then add to it this, and this is old Babylonian law, the way to do things, but police officers, they normally don't record things. They write down what was said from memory. That's their policy. And so everything they say is twisted against you anyway. And so your lawyer, of course, trying to record things, that was smart because after that meeting, if it had not been recorded, those federal agents would have written a summary of what was said.
Mm-hmm.
Believe me, it would have been to flatter them, not you.
Right.
That's human nature. You're not going to change that. But, of course, they've made an art out of it.
Right.
So it's just best not to talk. And even when your lawyer's there, it's even dangerous.
Yeah, I have found it a lot easier to let him do the talking. He's been schooled in this. It's just a different matter for them to joust with an attorney, and they know that. That's the one thing that seems to get them to back down, not always, but certainly if they are going to remain civil, that's the way to do it.
That's right. Justice Jackson, U.S. Supreme Court, career prosecutor. But he said this, no criminal defense lawyer worth his salt will ever, under any circumstances, let his client talk to the police. Well, that says it all right there. What is there to, and but policemen don't seem to understand that, or they don't want to, or they want you to talk so bad they'll say otherwise. Right. There's something I don't want to forget during this interview, and that's a recent Supreme Court decision handed down. I say Supreme Court, I mean the Supremes, the U.S. Supreme Court. It was a case out of Texas. And the Supreme Court said, if you are not in under arrest, that is in custody, and you're talking to the to a police officer, and I like to include in that anybody who receives a paycheck from the government, or anyone working in collusion with somebody that receives a paycheck from the government, from firemen and school teachers right on down the line. I've seen it all. But if you're talking to them and you're not under arrest or in custody and you decide not to talk and you don't say anything about the Fifth Amendment, that can be used against you in a criminal prosecution. And it was in this case that came out of Texas. What happened briefly, Larry, was I think it was Texas versus Salinas. A young man accused of murder, and police called him in. He'd been to a party, and they asked him, it was a few years after it happened, talked to him a little bit. He answered their questions, and finally one of them said, well, ballistics seems to indicate that the gun that was used in this murder matches your shotgun.
Oh, my.
And
what a load.
Yeah, a load, no pun intended. Huh?
No, no,
and he said, this fellow all of a sudden stopped talking, and he looked down at his feet and didn't say a word. And they waited a while. He didn't say anything. They said, okay, well, thanks a lot. And he left. And then a couple years later, read the case. I forget how long it was, but it was quite a while. He was arrested, tried for murder. And in the closing arguments, this prosecutor said that during the interview with the police, he refused to answer that question, although he answered all others. And he said not only that, he looked down at his feet, shuffled his feet, and he looked guilty. Well, the jury convicted him. They appealed. And wound its way up the Supreme Court. And the question was, can the prosecutor use a person's invocation of the right to remain silent or any fundamental right in the Bill of Rights against him? And the standard rule is, no, you can't do that. If someone takes the Fifth Amendment, you can't use that against them or mention it any time during the trial. Well, the Supreme Court said, in this case, you can. They said that because he was not under arrest. But if he wanted the Fifth Amendment, he wanted to use the Fifth, and he didn't want it to be used against him in criminal trial. He had to invoke the Fifth with words, making it clear that he was standing on the Fifth Amendment right to remain silent and the protection of the Fifth Amendment. They said there are no special words you have to use. You just have to make it clear. I have a lawyer
buddy.
What a
tap dance. That is just sick.
That was pretty strong. But, you know, there's another side to this, Larry. Like most things courts do, you can use them to your advantage. I think it's important now. I'm going to do this. If a policeman wants to talk to me, I'm going to say, have you read the most recent Supreme Court case, or as time goes on, the Supreme Court case, and I'll quote this, Texas versus Salinas. And, well, if you haven't read that, you need to read that. I can't afford to talk to you. I'll say right up front, before anything else is said, I stand on the Fifth Amendment to our U.S. Constitution. Whereas my attorney buddy down in Phoenix advises his clients, objection Fifth. Objection Fifth is two words.
And this is even during a traffic stop.
Well, you know, who knows how it's going to be applied. But I would say, of course, that's an area of law that is what the courts have called what do they call it? Semi-criminal? No, that's not it. Quasi-criminal, something like that. So they use it as a gray area so you can kind of just, it's mush. Who knows what's going on there?
Mm-hmm.
I think that any time a person feels threatened, it would be wise, and I'm just saying this as a guy that read the case. I haven't studied it all the way through, but I sat down and read it a couple of times, and I was amazed at what I saw. But it can be used to people's advantage. Maybe people will wake up, I'm saying, and learn, like with Miranda. They learned something with Miranda. They learned about the Fourth Amendment because of Miranda. It educated the entire country. Well, this case can be used to educate everybody in America. And maybe they'll just say, no matter what, well, I'm taking the Fifth. Before you start, you may as well say it. Because if any question is asked and you don't want to answer it, you don't say that. It can be used against you, whether you're innocent or guilty. And I
Now, once we've invoked the fifth, once we've invoked that, then we cannot say anything, because if we were to resume conversation, that would be to say, okay, forget the fifth.
That's pretty much right, Larry. Yeah, that's right, too. You know, silence, it's one of those things. Of course, it's in law, and this isn't equity. This is our version. This is our alternative to bullets. So it's a brutal system.
Back with Brent Allan Winter. He is the author of Don't Talk to the Police. You can find it at commonlawyer.com. Brent, you've had some experience yourself where you had occasion to apply what we're talking about.
Oh, precisely. A drug before the grand jury. Several occasions, of course, had clients that were contacted, and people would call me and say, there's federal agents here, what do I do? And usually, without understanding the circumstances, I advise them to take the fifth, and I've done the same thing myself. It's just why sometimes the government agents, employees will press the matter, sometimes they won't. I have had a few times where government or federal agents, now that I think of it, said, well, I can respect that. So there are always exceptions to the idea that everybody is involved with trying to destroy your rights. But I'd say it is a culture of trying to do so. And my family were, my wife and my six of my children were in a van and were stopped 200 yards from our house by police officers who were trying to get at me. I'm amazed at how orchestrated some of these things are, the feds and the state. And they asked my wife to exit the vehicle. I was at home in the office here. They tried to call me. For some reason, they couldn't get through. Of course, our house on the side of a mountain, so it's kind of hard. But they asked my wife to get out of the car, and she said, well, I won't talk to you unless my lawyer's here, and they couldn't get a hold of me. The sheriff's deputy took her to the back of the van. The children were in the van, and grabbed her arm and spun her around, slammed her down on the hood of the squad car, handcuffed her, threw her in the back of the squad car. Of course, by that time, she's under arrest.
That's an assault.
Well, yeah, it went to federal court. No, it was a lot of things, that's right. It went to federal court. It's still in federal court, put it that way. It's still in federal court, civil rights action. Then my daughter, my oldest daughter, got out, saw what happened as she watched, and she got out, and he told her to get back in the car, and she said, no, I can watch what's happening. That wasn't right. I witnessed it. And she is had her phone in her hand, tried to call me. He grabbed the phone out of her hand and
spun. That's another assault.
Yeah. Yeah. And, well, they were both put under arrest, taken to the jailhouse, and my oldest daughter is about 50% deaf, and he claimed that he told her to back away, and she didn't do it. A lot of things happened. I'm just saying, then they went, Larry, and called eight more deputies and got my children out of the car and harassed them for over an hour trying to get them to talk to them. And I had instructed them before they left the house, do not talk to any police officers, because I knew that there was trouble brewing. And no matter what you do, and my children, and they were from ages 22, the oldest daughter that was arrested, she was let out that evening, by the way. I went down and prevailed upon them, but they weren't anxious to let them out. When I finally said she was deaf, then they got a little worried, let them out. And they held them without cause. But my children did not peep a word. I remember the sheriff's deputies. I finally got down there. They wouldn't let me talk to them. Then they threatened me with arrest if I even got close. But
Another offense. I mean, they were really making it easy for you to bring suit.
Well, they were, and we did get into court. Courts, my observation is, they don't, federal courts, and this is a federal jurisdiction matter.
By the way, what was it they finally came up with, was the quote-unquote charge to justify?
Well, they finally said that they had obstructed justice, and the charges went up. It's a very long, it gets
but based on no reasonable suspicion, so that's
the stopping of the vehicle, no, there was nothing there, and that was the crux of the whole matter. You have to have some kind of reasonable suspicion or probable cause to stop a vehicle. That's right, Larry. And didn't have that. Of course, the arrest was false, too. And then the assault, and then there was other abuses that occurred. Of course, abused all of my children and threatened to take them away from our parents. Then they called DCFS, and they came down and were there to watch to make sure that in case the children had to be taken from the parents. It's an ugly machine. So when I say that we're approaching a police state, I'm I'm speaking from experience, and it didn't stop there. This went on for a few more years, and it got worse. But what I did discover, two things I had done. My lawyer, I had a lawyer then after that.
We don't like your attitude, boy.
Yeah. He said to me at one point at the zenith of the controversy, he said, "What do you think the message here is, Brent?" I said, "I don't know." He said, "Well, maybe you should not run for Congress again. Do you think that's the message?" I said, "Well, that might have something to do with it." And there were other messages that were sent. I had advised people to remain silent. And the system, I say the system, that's not the way to put it. The people that operate the system don't like the right to remain silent. And there's no sense in not saying so. They don't like it. And that's why it's important to invoke. It is fundamental to who we are. If a man or a woman can't control his tongue, then torture becomes the rule. Because if you don't have a right to control your tongue, I have a right as a government employee to make you talk. And the only way you can do that, if a person isn't going to talk, is by torture. Torture of mind, torture of body. And it can come in many different forms. It can come in threats, intimidation. It can come by jailing your family and leaving you alone. Say, "I'm going to jail your wife." That's what they did to me. That's torture. And torture has no part. See how all this is interrelated? I guess what I'm trying to say here, our common law is a seamless garment. And you cannot tear it apart. Torture and the right to remain silent come together. They can't be separated. Because if you don't have the one, you will have the other. And that's what, it's amazing to me now we're talking about torturing people. We have been for the last 10, 12 years. And that's been a debate. There's no debate. It's not part of our tradition. It is not our our Constitution, the slice of our common law, brief of common law government, and the limits for them, does not allow torture. It's no place to be found in the common law. No place. And so if it exists, it can exist only by positive decree of a tyrant.
So I think you've really come to a very important point. If we concede our right to remain silent, then we are in the same breath, if you will, on the other side of that coin, saying it's okay to torture.
No question. History, this is not just a conclusion. This is a fact. I can read history. I read about Nazi Germany. We have ways of making you talk. We used to see this in the movies. I thought that was just in the movies. It wasn't in the movies. They did have ways of making people talk, and they were brutal. And they did make people talk. Of course, the communists are POWs. They had ways of making them talk. I had a family member as a POW in Germany, and he told me the Nazis came in after they had him. They put him in a nice hotel room down in some big city, Berlin or someplace, and a man came in all dressed up in a fancy uniform, an SS troop, and spoke perfect English. Hmm. And he said, "If you want to talk to us, Mr. Armstrong, you can stay here. But if you don't want to talk to us, we have other plans for you." And as it turned out, they did. But amazingly, I don't think folks today see the connection between the Fifth Amendment and torture. It's all there. We must get a grip. Oh, by the way, Larry, I wanted to get this case out. The name of this case, the Supreme Court case, April 17, 2013, decided June 17, 2013. The name of it is Salinas v. Texas. But if you look, you Google it on the Internet, anybody that does it, that's going to come up. It's all over the Internet.
And just to repeat, that case basically concluded
Salinas, A-L-I-N-A-S, versus Texas.
And in one sentence or so, what did that case establish?
If you want to remain silent and it not be used against you in a criminal trial, which could happen to anybody, you must say, "I invoke the Fifth," or words like that.
Well, folks, you've heard it from a practicing attorney. Don't talk to the police. If you think there's anything beyond 5 miles over the limit and the possibility of incarceration, I invoke the Fifth Amendment. That's the last thing you should or have to say.